Hey everyone, Judicial Watch President Tom Fitton here with a special weekly update, launching my new Judicial Watch book, Rights and Freedoms in Peril, available October 15th. Get it now. Go to judicialwatchbook.com, go to Amazon, go to Barnes & Noble, go to wherever you get your books and purchase it. It is the book you need, especially during this time of national crisis. And exclusively on this special launch program for the book, we're making available on our judicialwatchbook.com website personally signed copies of the new book. So that means you make this special purchase, I will sign it. Not only will I give you my signature, I'll show you my signature here. Hold on 1 second. I think I signed one. Let me bring it up. There we are. Not only will I sign it for you, I'll even sign it to you, meaning your name will be in the book and I'll sign it personally to you. So two options. You can go to the judicialwatchbook.com website, just get the book normally, go on Amazon, go wherever. Otherwise, you can also make the special purchase to get the limited edition signed book from yours truly to you. And so it's a great memento for this historic age where our republic is under attack in ways never seen before in at least the modern era. And so what Judicial Watch has done and what we've done in this book is kind of laid out where the left is going after your rights and freedoms and how they are attacking the core institutions that protect them in our constitutional republic. And it doesn't matter the topic, they'll leave nothing unburned in terms of their destruction of our institutions and your rights and freedoms. The book talks about the planned chaos at the border, the lawfare targeting Trump, the First Amendment under attack in ways never seen before, whether it be censorship or your rights to petition your government. It's not just censorship, it's your right to petition your government that's under attack as well. The lies about January 6th. The media doesn't want to talk about the lies, but we quite factually go through some of the issues related to January 6th, especially the issue of Ashley Babbitt, whose family we represent in a $30 million wrongful death lawsuit. So an important book in that regard as well. And then, of course, it's election integrity. That's where the rubber meets the road in terms of our politics, right? How we elect our government officials is the way in which we express our will as a people. And the left, in my view, wants to end elections. We explain in the book how it is that's being done. So again, go to judicialwatchbook.com. The book comes out October 15th. You can get it now at judicialwatchbook.com. You can go over to Amazon, wherever. But if you go to judicialwatchbook.com, there are a limited number of books that I can sign personally to you. So make the special purchase right now. And I suspect it's going to sell out. So I encourage you to do it now. My guess is, I was thinking about this, the left is going to want to suppress this book. And this is why, to me, you should purchase it. And not only will you be sending a signal, because the media tracks very carefully how well these books do, you'd also be educating yourself as well during these dire, dire times for our country. And we talk about all the issues, I shouldn't say all the issues, most of the issues you care about. I was filming a promotion for the video, for the book earlier. And, you know, and one point I've been making is I suspect Barack Obama doesn't want you to read this book. Certainly Joe Biden and Hunter doesn't want you to read the book. Kamala Harris, she doesn't want you to read the book. Dr. Fauci, he doesn't want you to read the book. And I say that all facetiously because I doubt they're going to interfere directly with your book reading. But you know what I mean. This is the sort of information, this discloses the secrets, exposes the lies, by the government and people like those I've listed that have so damaged this great nation and continue to do so. And parts of the book I'm going to read for you now to kind of whet your appetite. You know, obviously the issue about the targeting of President Trump is really key, because not only is it abuse of power, it's election interference, there's attacks on the civil liberties, not only of Trump, but his supporters. You know, when I highlighted in the book our reaction to the outrageous convictions and abuse of Trump, especially the one up in New York, I noted it was a terrible day for the rule of law, and that will go down in infamy. The whole process is compromised, and the verdict should be overturned in an emergency fashion. And it hasn't yet, but it should be. And this next sentence not only covers what happened in New York, but applies to all the other fake prosecutions, abusive prosecutions targeting Trump. The evidence shows that Trump committed no crimes and that this is a prosecution about nothing. This and other Democratic Party political prosecutions of Trump are an abomination under law and are destabilizing to our nation. And to me, these prosecutions are a key way in which this election has already been compromised. Does it mean that Trump will win? Does it mean that Kamala will lose, or Kamala will lose, or Kamala will win and Trump will win, lose? I don't know. I don't know if the compromised nature of the election is going to impact the result in a way that undermines confidence in the results, right? But you can't keep a candidate held hostage for 6 weeks, practically speaking, up in New York in the middle of a campaign and pretend that doesn't have an impact on the election. Indeed, that prosecution and the prosecutions of him are a key talking point for his opponents. Isn't that convenient? Now, the next question is there going to be justice after Trump wins, or if he wins? And to me, that's the big question. Will there be accountability for these abuses? And I think the best way to ensure that there's accountability is by describing what really went on, as is in this book. Because unless you know who the bad guys are, how do you know what to do in terms of stopping what they're doing and holding them accountable? As I further write, as of this writing, the regime is engaged in a lawfare campaign to imprison Trump for life and to liquidate all his assets. I mean, that's the issue right now. They're subverting the core principles of our democracy as they gaslight the population with outlandish claims that Trump and each and every one of his supporters pose a threat to our democracy. And as I note, this isn't a campaign screed I'm talking about. This is just a straightforward analysis of the state of America. And again, the book is on sale at judicialwatchbook.com. Comes out October 15th. This is a massive, massive campaign by Judicial Watch to educate the American people. It's being published by Threshold, which is a division of Simon & Schuster. So this is a major, major book publication event. And it couldn't come at a more important time in our nation's history. This is the fourth Judicial Watch book. Each one of our prior books have been bestsellers. They've documented for the last 15, 20 years the corruption. And so if you want the latest guide to the current crisis and what to do about it, you're going to want this book. It's kind of like your handbook to figure out what the left is up to and what the response of responsible citizens should be. You know, and as you know, one of the key facets of the left's attack on America is disguised or relies upon this DEI, this woke approach, diversity, equity, inclusion, however it's currently being masked or called. But it's essentially a Marxist analysis of America. And it provides an argument to destroy America using this analysis. American system is compromised by systemic racism and other victimization of so-called protected classes, as far as the left is concerned. And the only way to rectify that is to destroy the system. If the system is systemically racist, then you have to break it, which is why they target our Constitution, which is they target the basic American understanding, certainly since the Civil War, that everyone deserves equal protection of the law. And this is why, and I'll talk about later, why they're trying to destroy our military, which is the institution that defends America and our rights and freedoms, using DEI as the Trojan horse to get it done. As we note, this new regime, born from the principles of critical race theory, was called diversity, equity, inclusion, and quickly became the defining organizational purpose behind many American institutions. On his very first day as president in 2021, Joe Biden promised to, quote, advance an ambitious whole of government equity agenda. Indeed, DEI is the central organizing principle, or a central organizing principle, for the Biden-Harris administration. You see this recently, I don't know if you've been tracking it online, with FEMA talking about, there are officials talking about in meetings about how disaster aid needs to be prioritized among so-called disadvantaged groups for purposes of equity, because disasters hurt these particular groups more significantly than others. They just make this up as they go along to justify their racialism. I guess that's a nice way of calling them racist, right? But it is a racialist approach. Everything is about identity in a way that's un-American, right? And we describe all of our work in here as it relates to DEI, our lawsuits to stop racist contracts in Minneapolis, their battles over reparations, mandates for race, ethnicity, and sex quotas in California. There are a few groups doing what Judicial Watch is doing here, exposing also what's happening to our military, as I'll talk about later. And I know you're concerned because it's 3 weeks or so before the election, even though outrageously people are able to vote already. That's another matter, right? And Judicial Watch, I would dare say, is second to none and has been in trying to ensure our elections are fair, free, and clean. And we've been punished as a result. The left hates us. They've retaliated against us. The Biden Justice Department has targeted us, Judicial Watch and me, remember that subpoena a few years back? I had to go in and testify to Jack Smith's grand jury because we had issues about the 2020 election. But it hasn't stopped Judicial Watch from suing to clean up the rolls, from other litigation to ensure that elections are free, fair, and clean. And I'll get to that in a second. Our election system is melted down into a nightmare scenario where millions of ballots could be mailed to addressees where a voter once lived. Campaign workers are paid to sniff around for blank ballots and encourage the holder to fill them out, that can be collected and brought to a polling place or dropped in the mail at some point around or after Election Day. They're opened and counted by temporary, lightly trained staffers who are counseled to go easy on matters such as who signed them or when they were mailed. Republicans who have long opposed the denigration of Election Day through ballot harvesting, early voting, and mail-in voting have been forced to swallow their opposition and compete for voters under these new rules. this political calculation may be understandable in the short term, but I worry in the long run that this will lead to the cementing of election rules that are fundamentally at odds with free and fair elections. It is no wonder that people have legitimate questions about the conduct of American elections. And it's also no wonder that the powers that are working overtime to make sure these questions don't get asked or answered. So, our book is must reading for the patriots. Rights and Freedoms in Peril, the Judicial Watch Investigative Report on the Left's Attack on America. Go to judicialwatchbook.com. As I said, there's a special purchase you can make, so I will that will get you a personalized signed copy from me, and I'm happy to do it. I'm looking forward to learning all of who you are when you purchase the book, because I'm going to see your name, right? And I'm going to thank you personally through the signature process. And obviously, just buying the book in the regular way, it's a great way to support Judicial Watch as well and get our message out. And I encourage you to buy more than one copy, because you're going to see it, you're going to say, I think I want someone else to have this. But you're going to want to keep your own copy. So to fix that, buy more than one copy. And I'm sure there are some, you know, you're going to get some good deals online for it. Get it. And it's important you get it next week, because the more people who purchase it next week, the more likely it is to get onto the bestseller list and stay there, which is the goal in terms of getting the word out about this important work. And, you know, as I was thinking about this book, of course, it was written, you know, I think it was written just as the Joe Biden was imploding and he was subjected to that coup. And I don't know how the election is going to turn out, but I can promise you this. All the issues we care about won't be solved by the new president, whoever he or she may be. President Trump may win. Republicans may take over Congress, but the threats to our election will never end. The threats to our borders will never end. The threats to our culture will never end. The obsession with destroying the Constitution, remaking the Supreme Court, etc., that will never end. The left never gives up. So the issues never go away. The challenges to our republic never go away. It might be mitigated some, depending on the leadership. But our opponents in these matters don't give up. And this is why Judicial Watch's work is essential. We've been working for 30 years to protect the country. And dare I say it, even though the country is not where we want it to be, it'd be a lot worse off but for your Judicial Watch. And I was just noting the other day, or earlier today, that Walz, the governor from Minnesota, you know, he was caught, and it's interesting, it's just basic questioning by even the friendly media, basically opposing the foundations of our federal constitutional republic by trying to destroy the Electoral College. And, I mean, he couldn't even answer a straightforward question on it. Let's go to that tape.
I want to go back to something you said on Tuesday. You said, I think all of us know the Electoral College needs to go. But the campaign came out later that night, and they said that's not their stance. Yeah.
Well, it's not the campaign's position. And the point I'm trying to make is that there's folks that feel every vote must count in every state. Mm-hmm. And I think some of folks feel that's not the case. Our campaign does that. And the point I'm saying is, I'm in five states in 2 days. We're out there making the case that the campaign's position is clear, that that's not their position. Their position and my position is to make sure that everybody understands their vote, no matter what state they're in, matters.
So that's something that you and Vice President Harris disagree on?
I have spoken about it in the past, that she's been very clear on this, and the campaign and my position is the campaign's position.
Do you understand what his position is? I don't. So it sounds to me like he wants to destroy the Electoral College. And it's a core fight for the left. Just because they're not campaigning, you know, the Kamala Harris campaign, I don't know what their positions are or anything, especially since their positions changed, and her position has changed so dramatically in the past. I mean, do you think the Electoral College should be thrown out? The fundamental basis, one of the fundamental bases of our Constitution. Remember, there was compromises that resulted in the creation of our nation and the U.S. Constitution. One of those compromises was the Electoral College. It's like a Jenga pile. You take that brick out, the rest of the system is damaged and collapses. So this is a revolutionary issue when it comes to elections. And, you know, and the battles continue in terms of election integrity. I mean, we have this great book, right? The reason we have this great book is because there's a lot of heavy lifting behind it in the federal courts. We have two cases now in Illinois and California to clean up the rolls. And we've cleaned up the voter rolls all across the land. And I talked about it in a quick video from the other day, or a few weeks ago.
This federal law requires an election day, not an election week, not an election month.
Hey everyone, you may not know this, but Judicial Watch, over the last year or two, our litigation has cleaned up 4 million dirty names from the voter rolls. More lawsuits ongoing to clean up potentially millions more in Illinois, California, another lawsuit in the offing for Oregon. Dirty voting rolls can mean dirty elections, and Judicial Watch is doing the heavy lifting to clean them up.
Yeah, I mean, if we're going to be mailing people ballots, don't we want to be sure they're there and are eligible to vote? I mean, as I note, we're about to sue in Oregon. I'm not sure when exactly we'll file a suit. I'm always a little hesitant because, you know, lawsuits, just because we're planning to file a lawsuit, you never know what's going to happen until it's filed, right? So the current plan is to file a lawsuit, and the numbers in Oregon are terrible in terms of their dirty voting rolls. Illinois, they've got a bunch of dead people on the rolls. California, they seem to essentially stop cleaning up the rolls for years there, even though we previously had forced LA County to remove 1.2 million names, or they were removed as a result of a settlement. So California would say it was a settlement, not we weren't forced. But the fact is the lawsuit led to that settlement, which led to 1.2 million names being removed. And let's play that initial, I had a tweet and an initial, that video we played initially. I want to get back to that. So this is key here. And let's play that video again. Let's be straight up about it.
This federal law requires an election day, not an election week, not an election month.
I mean, that's how elections can be, in my view, stolen. Through the illicit counting of ballots that they're not supposed to be counting, including ballots that arrive after Election Day. And we've alleged in two federal lawsuits, one in Illinois, one in Mississippi, that counting ballots that arrive after Election Day is unlawful. And not only that, I don't need to tell you why counting ballots after Election Day, or at least I hope I don't, why that invites voter fraud, undermines voter confidence. So the lawsuit in Mississippi just was heard by the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. So we're expecting, as I note in the tweet, a ruling on that any day. I think there are 18 or 19 states. Fifth Circuit ruling any day now. It wouldn't surprise me if it, I don't know, maybe it's too late in the day now. It may come out next week if it doesn't come out by the close of business today. But 18 or 19 states count ballots that arrive after Election Day. And I'm suspicious of counting of, by the way, this isn't in our lawsuits, but I think there's a legal issue here, counting ballots after Election Day, even if they got there on time. Because remember, in 2020, President Trump, on election night, he had the votes to win the election. But those results were changed as a result of unprecedented counting in the swing states that never taken place before, counting that went past Election Day. And we're supposed to pick the electors on Election Day. How does picking the electors on Election Day comport with counting ballots for days and weeks afterwards? And in the case of places like Illinois, counting ballots that arrive 2 weeks afterwards. It's one thing to dispute counting ballots you're already in, you got already in a box. But these are ballots that are still coming in. I think California, at 7 days, they count ballots. They let ballots come in for 7 days after an election. Nevada, they allow ballots to come in after the election and they get counted. Now, Pennsylvania, you're supposed to get your ballots in by Election Day in order for them to be counted. But there have been a series of stories telling us, oh, we won't know who won in Pennsylvania until days after the election. Well, that ain't right. And I would argue it's not legal. We've got this insanity going on in this country where we're told right is wrong and wrong is right. We had a story last week that came up that's been suppressed by the media about Vice President Harris's husband assaulting a woman 10 or 12 years back. Under the Trump rules, we'd have show trials over that, right? He's not even asked any tough questions on it. Here's his response to...
We don't have time to be pissed off. We don't have time to focus on it. It's all a distraction. It's designed to try to get us off our game.
Does it get you off?
No. All we are doing, all we talk about is this election. We understand the stakes. We understand the responsibility.
What are
the
stakes?
We understand the economy.
What are the stakes?
Our very country, our future. What kind of future are we going to have? Who would you like picking the next two or three Supreme Court justices? The guy who picked the three who overturned Roe v. Wade and want to take away more and more freedom? Mm-hmm. Or do you want Kamala Harris picking those Supreme Court justices?
So rather than deal with the allegations, credible allegations, he assaulted a woman, he defends himself by talking about the continued legalization or widening the ability of people to kill unborn human beings under law. I understand there are differences of opinion on abortion. What I don't understand, I guess I should because I understand the politics of it, but this obsession by the left, as you see there, and celebration of killing the unborn throughout all 9 months of pregnancy. They want it legal through all 9 months of pregnancy. Anyone who tells you otherwise is lying to you, either ignorant or lying. In politics, it's usually a mix of both, so it's hard to figure out which is which. And it's, the people call it a death cult. It's a sick death cult. So the governor, the left-wing governor of Michigan, went on some pro-abortion activist podcast, some feminist podcast, some social media interview of some type, and this is what she allowed to be filmed. Show that again. What sort of adult would think that's normal? It's vulgar. It mocks Holy Communion, Catholicism, Christianity, in celebration of abortion. It is sick. It is sick. And Judicial Watch does this work to expose the depravity around the pro-abortionist extremists that are running so much of our country in this regard, whether it be, wanting to give away abortion pills to everybody so that they kill their unborn children at home, or using tax dollars to sell the organs and skulls and heads of babies killed through abortion. And this is what they're doing, mocking those who want to protect life and extend the right to life to the preborn. I mean, there's corruption in politics, right? And then there's like corruption in a way that goes beyond politics, right? It goes to the soul of a nation and of a people. And that's that type of corruption. Is there anything else I'm supposed to be talking about before I go on? I get so outraged. And, you know, and by the way, I want to you to know, because I've done a few interviews on this book, I just get angry during every interview. So selling this book is going to be very stressful for me because it reminds me of everything that we're supposed to be outraged about and obviously what we need to do. So help me. Help me get this book out there. Mitigate my anger. You might get angry reading the book, but I think you're going to be pleased with the book because you may have like some ideas about what's going on, and you're going to say, read this book and say, I was right. You're right about what's wrong with America. You'll see it in Rights and Freedoms in Peril, the new Judicial Watch book that comes out October 15th. JudicialWatchBook.com. As I said, get the book there, get it at Amazon. And I want to remind you, through this special launch, we have made available personalized signed copies to you. You have to go on and purchase it specifically, and I'll sign the book to you personally of my latest book. Hopefully it's a bestseller, Rights and Freedoms in Peril. Okay. Now let's talk about what's going to be in the next book, right? And really, it's kind of part of a piece, right? So what you're going to like about in the book, I hate to keep on selling the book, but it's great because it's talking about Judicial Watch's work, and I think Judicial Watch is great. I'm sure you do too. That's why you're watching. And one thing Judicial Watch has been doing virtually alone is exposing the corruption and the concerns we have about the way the Secret Service is run. And we've highlighted how DEI is corrupting the Secret Service, how they've changed the standards, or they have very strange standards depending on whether you're a man or a woman in the Secret Service in terms of fitness requirements. As I've highlighted that, you know, the fitness requirements for active agents who kind of run around with guns are very different for men and women. A woman who operates at the highest level of fitness under the test would be in the lowest level of fitness if she were a man. And you saw the video of President Trump at Butler. I don't know, did we have that video? We posted something on Shorts the other day, didn't we? By the way, you saw the video of the women who were protecting the president with their lives, and I'm not downplaying their heroism. But the agency should not have put them in that position because it looks like to me they didn't fit the bill in terms of being able to provide the protection Americans would expect for President Trump or any other protectee of the Secret Service. So you have this DEI system, every day, every way, DEI, as we highlighted, is the number one priority for the Secret Service. And then just today, or the last day or so, it's broken that, and further confirmed, the Secret Service is denying Trump adequate security. He's had to cancel at least one major event. He's been warned by the Biden administration the Iranians want to kill him, and so he's asking for military protection, the type of military protection that Kamala Harris gets and President Biden gets, and I understand why. I'm not just saying they shouldn't get them, but given the threats and the fact he was almost killed twice, you would think they would want to go out of their way to provide him the extra protection, but they don't because it hampers his campaign. And dare I say, it places him at risk. And the left has made it a mantra to place President Trump at risk. They want to jail him, and too many on the left want to kill him. And that's how I interpret the refusal of the Biden-Harris administration to provide him adequate protection. It's not just incompetence. It's politics. And the Secret Service itself is a mess. So not only is it, you know, the politics, but you got to wonder who's running the show there. So Kamala Harris had some event. She went up to Massachusetts. I think it was a fundraiser or some type of political event. So she has a big Secret Service contingent. And there was video that emerged of them, Secret Service agents and other personnel, breaking into a private business. Let's go to that video. There's the agent. He sees the security camera, looks around. See, she comes back. Yep, she comes back. Here she comes back, gets the chair. And tries to cover up the video with tape. A Secret Service agent. There we go. And they break into the office to use the John or otherwise hang out. And so this just happened. When did this happen? July. It just happened in July. And Judicial Watch asked for documents about the scandal. Even the Secret Service was embarrassed about it. It happened on July 27th. And we asked for documents shortly thereafter. All emails and text messages of members of the Vice Presidential Protective Detail regarding the break-in by Secret Service officials of the 413 Salon in Pittsfield, Massachusetts. So we basically want to know what went on and who knew what and when. Simple FOIA request. And we've gotten the hand to the face from the Secret Service again, and we've had to sue. The New York Post reported on August 11th, the Secret Service apologized to a salon owner in Massachusetts who alleged, it's confirmed, that individuals broke into her business to use the bathroom during the agency's security work for a nearby Kamala Harris fundraiser. A Secret Service officer covered a camera outside her salon with tape. So the scandal's bad enough, and now they're covering up, and they tried to cover up the scandal quite literally by putting black duct tape over it, the camera. And now on top of that, they're denying us access to the information about what happened that day. As I say, the Biden-Harris Secret Service broke into a business and tried to cover it up. And they're still trying to cover it up. So as I said, Judicial Watch has been second to none in trying to figure out what the Secret Service is all about. We sued over to DEI. We exposed how Joe Biden's dog, because this is in the book, you got to get the book to see the details here. You're not going to believe the stories about Joe Biden and his dogs. And they're kind of unpleasant to read about in some ways. What's outrageous about it is that Joe and Jill's dogs attacked and bit 25 Secret Service agents, and no one would have done a thing about it but for Judicial Watch uncovering it. And we wonder why the Secret Service is dysfunctional. Imagine if your work go to work and your boss lets his dog bite you. He says, oh, sorry. And you go in the next day, he bites you again. Oh, sorry. And nothing's done. That's today's Secret Service. And they're breaking in? We had an American Revolution to protect our property from improper search. Well, actually, it was like quartering troops. It's more on point there. It's outrageous. And as we're hearing today, they still don't have the proper protection for Donald Trump. I know you're worried about what, some people are worried about whether he's going to win. I'm worried about whether he's going to live, given the way the Secret Service has been operating. But don't worry, Congress comes back 2 weeks after the election, and they'll handle it then. So the other crisis we're facing, as I talked about in the book and we talked about earlier, is the DEI insanity. And it's infecting our military. It is the number one operational or organizational goal or way of thinking in the military these days. And Judicial Watch has been working with and represented STARS, which is a organization of retired military officers. It's short for Stand Together Against Racism and Radicalism in the Services. And their mission is to help educate our fellow Americans regarding the criticality of having a military that focuses solely on the essential readiness needed to fight and win our nation's wars. So they're old-fashioned people. They think that the military should be training its troops and in the critical focus of winning wars, as opposed to winning cultural fights to undermine America. And it's just, again, this is not an academic exercise. People are losing their jobs. People are being abused in the military, drummed out. Don't think the vaccine push was an indirect way of throwing out people who didn't sign on to this DEI push or were unlikely to. There's this bias against conservatives in the military as a result. And I was glad to see, and he's associated with STARS, who we're working with and suing to get access to information about what's going on. And I'll get to that in a minute. But Matt Lohmeyer, who was a senior officer in the Space Force, I think he's former Air Force, he moved to Space Force, and he was exposing this insipid Marxism in the military. And Trump had an event the other day, and Matt went to it and presented to Trump personally about what's going on. And I cannot compete with Matt in explaining it. And so that's why I'm going to turn it over to this video.
My name is Matt Lohmeyer. I was an Air Force F-15 pilot, and I was a commander in your newly created U.S. Space Force. I am also the first veteran of the Space Force because under the Biden-Harris regime, I was fired from my command and lost my pension for criticizing DEI trainings that were rampant in the military. Those trainings are still dividing our troops, and thank you for saying you would fire those few woke generals who are a big problem.
They're gone.
Will you consider establishing a special task force, office, or position to ensure that these monsters never return to the Defense Department?
You know what I'll do? I'm going to put you on that task force. I think it's good. Not going to do better than that. I'll put you on. Beautiful. I have your approval.
Yes, sir.
So, I mean, you see what's going on there. I mean, Matt lost his job for highlighting the abuses of his colleagues. I mean, we're supposed to be defending money on defense, not Marxist indoctrination. And Judicial Watch has taken a lead in trying to expose these issues in our military academies. West Point, the Naval Academy, the Air Force Academy. And for those of you who don't track these issues that carefully, I'm not a veteran, so I'm kind of looking from the outside as well. But these are the academies that train our future generations of leaders. It's not even the next generation, but it's the next generations of leaders. And we have uncovered in West Point, over in Annapolis at the Naval Academy, and in Colorado and the Air Force Academy, this DEI anti-Americanism that's being foisted upon our young men and women who just are there to defend the country. I mean, think of the honor. And I'm sure that many of you have known people in your community, the sons and daughters of your friends, right, who've made it into the military academies. We all celebrate that. And I'm trying to think back. I remember there was a guy in our community back home where I was raised in New York, and everyone knew he went to West Point. We all celebrated it, and what it was such a big deal. And for our leadership in the military to kind of betray that celebration, that trust, that patriotism by abusing those men and women now with this DEI training is really, to me, unforgivable. So we have a new lawsuit because, you know, it's one thing for me to yell about things, right, and to share your outrage. It's another thing to try to do about it, expose it, and stop it. And this is what this lawsuit is designed to do. It's designed to uncover more details about the DEI trainings and how they're covering it up at the U.S. Air Force Academy. We filed it on behalf of the STARS Veterans Group. We sued the U.S. Department of Defense. That's how you get the documents for the Air Force Academy. And essentially, they did a DEI assessment. We wanted documents on that assessment. You know, how they were tracking the demographics and of the cadets. Because the thinking is they treat some cadets differently based on their race. Is there woke racism at the Air Force Academy? Looking at the DEI training, one has to conclude there is. It's not just training. It could be practice. This is a statement from the DEI report from the superintendent in 2013. The United States Air Force Academy Diversity and Inclusion Plan 2012 revision is an action plan for D, E, and I that Team USAFA will implement over the next 5 years. The annexes are a set of living documents for each mission partner and directorate. My staff and I will evaluate the content found in the annexes at the close of each fiscal year so that the first evaluation will take place in 2013. So they began the systemic training under the Obama administration. It was, my understanding is generally it was paused, or Trump attempted to pause it during his administration, and then it went full bore again under the Biden administration. So when we're asking for these assessments, we want to know how they were tracking this DEI and what were they doing. It's a great little FOIA, right? Because this is the value of working with experts who know what to ask for, because they said, oh, they've got this bureaucratic process to track their DEI. We get to ask how they're doing it here. Get the documents. That's what I love about Judicial Watch, is that you know we learn something every day. I mean, we've been doing FOIA for 30 years, but when you know folks who know where the documents are buried, and then you figure out a way to ask for them, that's just great. It's just great. DEI seems like job number one for our nation's military academies. The Biden-Harris Defense Department is obsessed with indoctrinating our rising military leadership with woke anti-American ideology. This lawsuit aims to expose and stop this abuse of the young men and women in the Air Force Academy. I mean, in West Point, I mean, I go back through some of our older lawsuits, and I forgot until I looked at this release again. We sued earlier this year because the West Point people changed the motto. Or change the mission statement. The motto's still there, but they removed it from the mission statement. The motto was duty, honor, and country. And they took it from the mission statement, to the outrage of many. We've already found at the Air Force Academy in previous litigation that race and gender instruction is a top priority there. So you know how that's going to work, right? If you're the wrong race or the wrong gender, you're on the outside. West Point. They talk about modern-day slavery in the United States to their young men and women they're training. I mean, who's running the show over there? AOC? Or the generals? Or even worse, do the generals agree with AOC? One would think. I don't know who the next president's going to be, but if they're concerned about the future of our military, they got a lot of work to do. And Judicial Watch hopefully will provide the material and the background for the work they need to do. So before I go, one more time, everyone, Rights and Freedoms in Peril. This is the book you need. This is the book patriots need. This is the book Americans need to understand the threats to our country from the radical left. They want to destroy America, our Constitution, and the institutions that protect your rights and freedom. And this book explains how and what you can do to save your country. Again, Rights and Freedoms in Peril at judicialwatchbook.com. Have a great week. Happy Columbus Day. I know the left doesn't want us to celebrate Columbus Day. I remember the church a few years ago noted it's the celebration of the evangelization of the Americas. So Monday not only is Columbus Day, but you can also consider it in terms of the civilization of the West. The 532nd, right? Is it 32 years since 500? Yeah, I think it's 532nd anniversary of the evangelization of America, of the Americas. And of course, we celebrate the contribution of our of the Italian heritage to the United States as well that day. So celebrate America, celebrate the founding of America or the West on Columbus Day. Don't let the left distract you. It's a day of celebration. And with that, I wish you the best, and I'll see you here next week on the Judicial Watch Weekly Update.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button and like our video down below.